please stand for the reading of the word? How are you this morning? Nice and warm. Okay. Today our reading will come from the book of Matthew, the 5th chapter, verses 1 through 10. And it reads, "And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. And the last verse, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." I've read to you Matthew, the 5th chapter, verses 1 through 10. May God add a blessing to the readers, listeners, and doers of his most holy word. May we please bow our heads. Father, we come to you today. We come to you with our head bowed down to Mother Earth, but our hearts are elevated to the heavens above. Create in me a clean heart and renew in me the right spirit so I might be able to come before your people and deliver this corporate prayer. I'm asking you to just bless this church as a whole, bless its members individually and collectively. Bless the ministers of this church. Bless the ministries of this church. Bless the ministry leaders because they're the ones that's helped lead us into your kingdom. Bless the pastor of this church, for he has given us his look of how God wants us to operate in this kingdom. So bless his being. Bless all that's about him. Bless his family, for they are the ones that's holding him up besides the church so that we might be able to help him lead us because we need a leader, a strong leader, and he has proven to be just that type of a leader. So we shall follow him. Bless the mothers of the church. Bless the fathers. Bless the children. Bless this ministry, this music ministry, because they're the ones that's going to prepare our hearts so that we might be able to enjoy what the pastor is going to bring to us today in his sermon. Bless those that's visiting because they're the ones that might be someone that's come running to him and say what they must do to be saved. All these things we ask in your son Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord, New Bethel. Come on and just clap your hands for Jesus this morning. We came to worship him. We came to lift him up. We came to praise his holy name, for the name of the Lord is good. For our God is worthy of all the praise. feeling today. Is everybody all right? I know it's a little cold outside, but we came in here to praise the name of Jesus. We won't let the cold weather keep us bound, but we will lift up a shout of praise in this room because the Lord is worthy. Hallelujah. For he is worthy. We come to welcome you this morning. Is there any first-time visitors in the room? If we do, if you don't mind waving your hand so we can acknowledge you. If we do have any that are online, we welcome you to New Bethel Missionary Baptist Church, where our pastor and first lady greet you in the name of Jesus. And if you all don't mind to stand with us and sing this song, just in case somebody might be watching that are new, we want to make sure that they feel welcome. And most importantly, we want to welcome the Spirit of God.
November 14th through November the 20th can be found on page 3 in your bulletin. Upcoming events, November 20th is Youth Sunday. If you want your child to sing in the choir, please bring them out to rehearsal Thursday, November 17th at 6 p.m. Harvest Family and Friends Day is November 27th at 10 a.m. Thanksgiving Food Baskets Giveaway, November 22nd from 1 to 3 p.m. Deacon Ames has asked for 100 turkey donations from the New Bethel Church. If you know a family in need of a basket, please complete the sheet located in today's youth bulletin. Give it to an usher or Deacon Amos. Volunteers needed for the Nehemiah Men's. No experience necessary. Contact Deacon James Augustus. Children in youth ministry, contact Deacon Tyrone Smith. Food pantry, contact Deacon Amos. Kingdom Builders, Sister Javetta Carr or Sister Charlotte Hood. Donations are needed for hand weights, resistance bands, yoga mats, or other exercise equipment are still needed. Don't forget to log in Miles from 250 Miles Walking Club. To report any member who is sick in the hospital or report any deaths, you may call the church office on Monday, Thursday, and Friday from 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. You can also get a prayer request card from an usher. Everyone is asked to continue supporting our all-in building fund and media ministry. Don't forget to include your prayers, our members, relatives, and friends. those in bereavement, servicemen and women, our leaders in our churches and our country. Thought for today from God's chewable vitamin C for the spirit, acquiring the Lord's attitude requires listening to his inner voice. Psalms 46:10 says, be still and know that I am God. Y'all have a good day.
here. Father, I thank you and I bless you. You are an awesome God. There's nobody beside you in all the earth. We command every distraction and everything mentally that's trying to come against our worship today. We bind you in the name of Jesus. This is a place of worship. This is a place of sacrifice. I want to tell somebody that whatever news, whatever things you got before you got here, I want you to lay them before the Lord. Don't let anything take your mind off of lifting up Jesus. Come on, close your eyes real quickly. Nobody's going to steal your pocketbook. But just focus on him, and he's highly exalted. Come on. He's highly, take a deep breath. Take a deep breath. Some of you are stretched. You are bound. Take a deep breath and let that air out because the Lord is here to deliver you. Come on. Come on. We declare. Come on, take a deep breath. Come on, breathe in. Breathe out. Even online. If you're at home, come on. Come on, take a deep breath in. Come on, Lord, I thank you. Lord, I bless you. Come on. Lord, there's nobody like you. Come on, come on, come on. Move every distraction. Hurry up just a little bit. Come on. Move, remove every distraction. Father, I thank you. Father, I bless you. Lord, there's nobody like you. Nobody like you. Nobody like you. Come on, every hand lifted, God, I surrender. My mind, my thought process, things that are trying to cloud my judgment. Satan, the Lord rebuke you. But thank you for a sweet Savior. Thank you for a sweet Spirit that I can worship in, that I can lay all my burdens down. One more time. Nobody like you. There's nobody like you.
Nobody like you.
Nobody like you.
Nobody like you.
You're an all sufficient God.
Like you.
And we've searched all over. Your name is Jesus, Jesus. Your name is Jesus, Jesus. And I cast all of my cares and my burdens. Every worry, God, I cast it on you right now. Every distraction, I cast it on you right now. I declare that there's nobody like you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Our teens and our youth church are getting ready to leave. Let's clap our hands for them as they are heading to the other side of the campus. Come on, come on, lift it up for them as they're still worshiping. And then as they make a hole, when you fill that hole in and move up a little bit, nobody like you. Come on, worship us. Nobody like you. You're a good God. You're a good God. You're a gracious God. Get your Bibles, get your Bibles. Turn with me to Proverbs chapter 18. Lord, let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. Lord, you're my strength and my redeemer. Good morning, New Bethel. I said good morning.
Good morning.
So good to see you all that are here and lifting up the name of the Lord Jesus. How many people are excited about what God's going to do? How many are thankful for what he's already done? Yeah, he's been good. This can't be a one-time thing. This has to be all the time where you lift up his name. Some trust in horses. Others trust in chariots. But we will. Somebody say we will. Trust in the name of the Lord. Another scripture say, for the name of the Lord is a strong power. And the righteous run in. They are saved. I don't know what you came in here with, but you don't have to leave with it. Yeah, I said it again. Because you missed it. I don't know what you mean. Wait. But you don't have to leave with it. He is a God that wants to get all of your cares, all of your worries, and in exchange, he wants to give you peace that surpasses all understanding. He wants to give you beauty for ashes. Come on, laughter for mourning. He's a good God. Do you have Proverbs chapter 18? Look at verses 1 through 2. We're going to read it from the New American Standard Bible. And for those who missed my teaching on the multiple versions of the scriptures, pastors still say, even though he don't read out of the King James on Sunday, King James is not just for Sunday. There is some meat in these other versions. You want to stay away from the Jehovah's Witness Bible, the New Living Translation. Stay away from that one. That's not a different translation. That is an alternation. They are altering the Word of God. You want to stay away from the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. That Bible is not the same. When I read from the New American Standard Bible, we are amplifying the King James. Somebody say amen to that.
Amen.
Here's what the Word of the Lord says in Proverbs chapter 18. He who separates himself seeks his own desires. He quarrels against all sound wisdom. He quarrels against all sound wisdom. A fool does not delight in understanding, but only in reveling his own mind. A fool does not delight in understanding. Will you just look at somebody and say, neighbor?
Yeah.
Community equals spiritual growth. Come on, tell somebody else, say, community equals spiritual growth. Give the Lord praise as you sit down from the Wisdom Series. It is so important, my brothers and sisters, that I note to you that this sermon series that I've been preaching to you is a challenge. It is a challenge because we need to grow spiritually. I'm not sure where you are in your walk with the Lord. I'm not even sure where you end with this year. Some of you are on the brink of the beginning of the year. You're trying and you're looking to make some changes. Some of you possibly may be looking to change where you worship. You may be looking at where to work at. You're looking at where to move. Some of you have plans to do some big things at the beginning of the year. And so December 31st is kind of your shedding moment. You shed the old and you're looking forward to new. Here's what pastor's advice for you to be is that you really seek God on your next steps. That you really find God in your next steps. Don't let your emotions, don't let what people say, don't let chatter move you in a direction that God has not ordained for you. Because if you move by your emotions, here's what your emotions will do. They will always, 100% of the time, lie to you. You can be mad with somebody a minute, and then later, 2 minutes later, you forget what you're mad at, and y'all laughing like nothing happened. That is your emotions. Your emotions will make you hold grudges. And watch this. When you get in your emotions, you don't even know why you're mad. Have you ever been mad at somebody? You don't even know why. You can't remember why you're mad, but you just know you're mad. What's happened is you develop a stronghold. And that stronghold has now made you not really understand what God is trying to say. So when you are on a stronghold, you cannot hear God. And the believer's kryptonite is not being able to hear God. If you've ever been in a season where you really can't hear God's voice, just raise your hand. Isn't that a frustrating season? Isn't that a lonely season? Isn't that a scary season where you just feel, you sense that you can't hear God? It's not that God is not talking. It's just that there are some variables that are making it hard for his message to get to you. I can tell you that you're blessed. I can tell you that God's going to do a great thing. But if your heart is not ready for that, my message won't be communicated to you. And here's the problem. We'll blame the preacher because we'll say, well, it's your job to effectively communicate. Well, then what I would say is, it is your job to have your heart ready to receive what God is saying. That's why you can't sit down and worship. Because worship prepares your heart for me to communicate God's word. Thank you for the two claps that I got right there. Because the problem is that we don't think worship is important to the word. We're ready for the preacher, but we miss the appetizer. Can I tell you all something? I love eating the main course, but there's something about some mozzarella sticks before my main course come out. It's something about some wings. Have you ever been to Brick Top? It's something about them donuts they bring out with that icing before your meal comes out. What I'm saying is the appetizer prepares you for the meal. In other words, the word of God is going to be preached, but how can you receive it if your heart's not ready? You got in an argument before you came in on the parking lot. Somebody texted you while you were walking in. The ushers didn't let you in before praise and worship was done. So all of these variables, you now are mad and you really can't receive the word. And you think, you really think you're going to receive this holy word and your heart is wrong? What happened is the word will be planted but you'll fall by the wayside. Yeah. You'll be stony ground. You'll have thorns, and that word that was planted, it'll be choked. It'll be captured. It won't bring forth any fruit because it had no root. But look at your neighbor early in the sermon and say, get your heart prepared. Well, listen, they look at you funny because they got an attitude. Just go ahead and lift your hands and say, I'm going to prepare my heart. God, I worship you in the beauty of holiness. God, I magnify you. Why? Because I can't miss an opportunity to get some word sown in me. See, we come to church and we miss opportunities. We miss it because of all the things that are going on. We got decisions to make. We got bills to pay. We got life going on. We got all this stuff. We got grandmates. We got children. We got co-workers. All this stuff is trying to vie for your attention. And what you're trying to do as a good Christian is that you're trying to give everything equal attention. But here's the problem. Can I tell you that I don't treat all my children the same? Because they are different. Some need a push on other things and others don't need a push on. In other words, God says to you that everything in your life does not deserve your equal attention. It may deserve attention, but not equal attention. You need to prioritize what now is what is suitable for your attention and what needs are not. It's called a checklist. When I wake up in the morning, I got a checklist, and my first checklist 5 years ago, I'm going to check my phone. I'm going to check the news. I'm going to check Facebook. I'm going to see what's going on in the world because I want to get all information that I missed while I was asleep. But as I've grown in God, the first thing I do now is I don't even just tell him thank you, but I go into a season and a moment of prayer because I want to thank him for keeping me over the night. I want to thank him that nobody broke in my house and killed me while I was asleep. I want to thank him that I didn't take my last breath. Close my eyes. I just want to take some time to thank you because the news can wait, but God can't wait. But they that wait on him change. My priority list has changed. God will give you glory. I know on social media no more, so I only have to check the news. I don't care what's going on. All I care is that you're still on the throne. And if you're still on the throne, it don't matter if the Republican or Democrats in office, your will is going to be done. I don't care if Herschel Walker's saying crazy, so that don't mean nothing to me as long as your will is going to be done. I don't care who your person is in office, my God shall supply all my needs. Can I give you a secret? I prospered when there was a Republican, and I prospered when there's a Democrat. You know why? Because I serve the King of Kings. And look, anybody got a testimony that you're not red or blue, but you're covered by the blood, and it don't matter what color you represent.
Yeah.
We can't ignore these proverbs that that Solomon has given us. And I told you last week, these are not Hallmark cards. This is not just a book of wisdom. This is God's holy word. It is God speaking through a king. God is telling you that if you follow what he's telling you in his word, the divorce rate will go down. If you follow what his word said, sickness would go down. If you follow in his word, church strife would go down. But the reason we can't get happy is because we become accustomed to mess and not being missionary. We've been accustomed to gossip and no gospel. We've been accustomed to auxiliaries with no anointing. In other words, we want everything external, but we don't want God to get in our business. Y'all didn't say the word. Have you ever had God get in your business? He began to tell you some stuff about yourself that you tried to hide. And then you be like, man, I didn't know I was that bad. He said, well, you are bad, but I can clean you up. Oh, your sins be as scarlet. I don't make them white as snow. Come now. Let us reason together. God is saying, I'm telling you about yourself, not to make you feel bad, but so you can get it together. This text, this wisdom series is about you looking at your spiritual walk. I want you to think about community. And then are you just a Sunday Christian? And pastor is going to get in your face again. Because it is time out for this baby sexy Christianity. Babyfying, pacifying everybody who's mad just because you think your tithe is bigger than somebody else's tithe. We're not babying you. We're calling you to be spiritually strong. And this sexy gospel where they got the lights off and playing slow music to you. Come on. I gotta see and let there be light. I gotta see what's going on. Sexy and baby-fied gospel. He says, where is your spiritual walk?
Come on.
Are you growing in God? Are you making an effort to get to Sunday school? Or, thank you for the two amens, or are you making excuses of why you can't grow spiritually? And I don't want to hear, I can do it on my own, because God never called you to grow on your own. You need community. Why do you think people join gangs? Because they need community. Why do you think people smoke together? Because you need community. Why do you think people go to jobs with other people? Because you need community. You were never designed to grow by yourself. And stop lying to yourself. I pulled myself up from my own bootstraps. You ain't done nothing. Somebody gave you a job. Somebody let you borrow a couple of dollars. Somebody let you borrow that car. They gave you a bus pass. You had some help. Lie we tell ourselves is that I've done it all. No. I'm asking you about your spiritual walk. Are you growing in your faith? Are you the same person you was this time last year? Are you still sending the same text messages? Are you still doing the same stuff? Are you still liking the same posts? Are you still acting the same way? I get on men, and men, and some men don't like me when I get on this. I get on them during football season. You mean to tell me that football season means more than God? Yeah, I said it. Yeah, I love football, I love sport, but you mean to tell me that you leave the church early to go watch your team play, and you ain't got no stock in the team. You ain't make the team. They don't even know you. And that overrides God, and then you lie to yourself, but after football season, I'll get back to it. No, the devil is alive. Now is the time for the true worshipers. Thank God for DVR. You can take it. Y'all, boy, y'all tough. That's right. Are you spiritual walk? Number two, how are you handling your assignments?
Right.
Based on the word, how are you doing as a husband? Now, I didn't say how the culture's telling you.
Right.
And don't even look at your spouse, because they may have a different view. No, how are you following God's plan as a husband? Ladies, don't shoot me down with your amens. How are you doing as a wife?
All right.
Are you following God's plan, or are you following auntie? Are you feeling Big Mama? Because Big Mama did it this way. But no, what does the Bible say? Thank God for Big Mama. Thank God for Uncle Bud. But what does the Bible say? How are you doing as a single person that's dating somebody? Are you a roadblock to that person? Are you leading them down a road of sin? Meaning that you're supposed to be the Christian, but you sit in the late night text. You're supposed to be the believer. You're the one quoting Bible scripture saved in the morning. But are you the one that's sending a text and let's pick up later on? How are you handling your assignments? Are you moving towards God or are you moving away? That's what this wisdom series is about. It's about us challenging each other to move towards God, not away from God. And I don't care, listen to me, I don't care how bad it gets, God will never leave you. Can I tell you, let me give you this third point. How are you handling your parental responsibility? Are you challenging your children to know about? My daughter said something to me, one of my daughters said something to me so profound today, it blessed me, and I know she won't lie because I didn't ask for it. Typically, they try to tell me what they want me to hear when they want something. She didn't want us. I knew it was the truth. You said you ain't saying that to me. I knew it was true, but she didn't want it. Typically, oh, dad, you look so handsome. What do you want? I know you don't just. I know, but I, you know, you don't just say that. This time, she just came out and told me. She says, I'm learning. She said, it's children's church today. Teacher. I said, yeah, that's right. I said, well, you don't want to hear me preach? She said, Dad, you're good, but I learn so much when I'm back there. Excuse me. No, she said, I love the worship. I love when you preach. I love when you say that. But she said, I just get it. I get more. I'm getting a lot while I'm back there. And as a parent, my heart began to shout. Because she's a part of a church. Y'all got to go. Y'all get your point. As a dad, what she's saying is, yeah, you're good. I love you, Dad, but there's something for me, and I'm getting it as a parent. All you parents that got children back there, you should be rejoicing that they're getting something. See, we're not just a church that just worships on Sunday. We are a 6-7-day organism. Why? So that people can grow in their faith.
Amen.
She blessed me. And then I said, well, you know, I said, so you like when I say yes? She said, yeah, I like when you say yes. But she said, you know, every now and then, I just like going back there. Hope you're not mad. No, I'm not mad. Really, I was like, well, nah, you trying to say I can't preach. In other words, as a believer, watch this, she's growing in her faith. We're pushing her as parents, not as Pastor Norris, but we're pushing her as parents to grow her faith. Because society is trying to tell her how to handle her faith.
Yes, that's so true.
Society telling my sons and your sons how to handle their woman. Yeah. I tell you, ladies, that if you follow God's word, men, if you follow God's word, you will be all right.
Right.
Problem is, that we get too big for our britches. Church is born in. We blame the preachers. We blame this. We blame style of preaching. No. The problem is that if you watch this, the best way to engage in class is to read the chapters before you get to class.
That's right.
Amen.
I know y'all don't like that because you're trying to do it when you're in school. But if you read the chapter before you get there, you got something to participate in. You got to spend time in this word even when you're not here on Sunday. What's next for you in God? What's next? Are you? What's your spiritual walk like? Are you handling your assignments? What's next for you in God? Look at your life. Look at what you want. Is it buying a new home so that God can use it for a small group? Is God going to bless you to get married? Is God going to give you the new job so that your giving can go up? What's next for you in God? And these texts, what I'm teaching you, is about you looking at these three areas. These three areas to say, Lord, what's my spiritual? Am I just here on Sunday and then I'm not here no more? Am I just showing up so that if I do happen to die or get sick, I got somebody to pray for me? Am I here because I got the right reason? Like really, what's my walk with the Lord? And my challenge to you is really look at how you are engaging God and ask God, what's next for you and I? Yeah. It's kind of like that moment when a woman asks the man that had been dating for 27 years and he ain't put a ring on, and she say, what are we? God, what are we going in this season? God, what's next? How does my prayer life get strong? How do I become a student and a faithful member to Sunday school? How do I get engaged in church? Can I help you out that this text is really about us stopping all this anti-socialism and this church hurt and really getting locked into ministry? Can I tell you that every church has imperfections? Every pastor has imperfections. Every choir has imperfections. Every auxiliary has imperfections. But here is the point, that if you don't get locked into community, I ain't talking about where you just know a couple of people and you a couple of people keep a mess. I'm saying, no, how do I get locked into community? That means I got to know somebody on the other side of the church that I never talked to. But if I want to build community, we got to know each other. I ain't got to know your business, but I need to at least know your name. See, we think when we introduce ourselves, I got to know your business so that way I feel safe, or I feel like you're going to be here for a while. If you come and go, that's between you and God. But I at least want to know your name, so if God puts your face in my spirit, I know a name to pray for. I can't just say pray for that person that has a red shirt on the side of the church. No, Lord, I want to know their name because I want to build community, because community is equal spiritual growth. Look at this real quickly. Proverbs is this depiction. It's a depiction between wisdom and folly. Y'all still here?
Yeah.
Between wisdom and folly. Solomon says, if you follow God's wisdom, you'll have long life. If you continue to walk in foolishness, that's why you keep bumping your head. Say it again. If you follow God, everything gonna be fine. Not saying you're not gonna have no hardships, but you're gonna make it through. But if you keep following foolishness, you're gonna keep bumping your head. Here's the good thing about God. God will bless you while you're in foolishness, and you'll think God is okay with that, but God is not okay with that. He's just saying, I'm giving you space enough to repent. You don't hurry up and get it together. You don't keep bumping your head. If you bump your head long enough, you're going to pass out. And if you pass out, you're unconscious. You're unconscious, so can't scream for help. And if you stay unconscious long enough, you'll go brain dead. Y'all ain't said nothing to me. So God says, why don't you quit bumping your head on the same thing, but allow me to lead and guide you in all your ways. Acknowledge me, and I will do what? Direct. Last week, here was the question. Do you care? And we looked at our relationship between us and God. The beginning, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise. Fools don't want to come to church. Fools think that they're right and everybody else is wrong. Fools take one bad situation, harp on that bad situation, and now won't worship God based on that bad situation. Fools. The Hebrew word of fools was evil. People that don't have the right heart for God, they'll come and just look. Do you know people that just look for something wrong?
Yes.
They got a problem with you, so they already got a problem with you. And, Eric wore red today. I don't even like red. They ain't got nothing to do with you anymore. But because I got a problem with Eric, I'm looking for anything to make my problem magnified. Y'all do it all the time. We do it all the time. You don't like something, you don't like a restaurant, and somebody recommends that restaurant, but because you don't like that restaurant, you complain about the restaurant the whole time you're there. They chips ain't as good, and they meat ain't as good. Look at their drinks are wild. You just don't like this restaurant. Drinks are good. Drinks are fine. They got plenty of ice and a pink lemonade. But because your heart already has an issue, the littlest thing, y'all ain't said nothing to me. In church, and so Solomon says, do you really care? Do you really care how you're treating God?
Right.
Do you really care about the stuff you say about God's people? Do you really care of how you're acting in church? Do you really care about your bad attitude? Do you really care that the fact that you're openly being disobedient, and but then acting like you ain't being disobedient? Do you care that listen, my sincerity again, I'm off of it. Do you really care that God is telling you to do something and you're not doing it and you think that's okay? Do we really care? Here it is this week, our relationship with ourselves and God. In other words, I want you to look at in this text, how does God look at me? Let's look at the text right here. Look at Proverbs 18. He says, he who separates himself seeks his own desire. Can I help you that sometimes even Jesus, he had to get by himself to hear from God? I'm not talking about moments of isolation. What I'm saying is that the reason that people have issues with churches is because they don't get locked in, they don't put any roots in. And if you don't put any roots in and you become isolated, that means you're not serving in any ministry, or the person you don't like is over the ministry, so you're not going to help. So therefore, you distance yourself, talking about God leading you a different way. When you become isolated, here are the three things that happen to you. When you become isolated and you get away from community, here's what happens to you all. You become messy, you become miserable, and you become a mumbler. You become messy because your person is not in charge. So therefore, you want to poison as many people as you can so they don't support the person that you don't like. I'll let that sink in. Well, if you're not messy, you become miserable. In other words, you sit there and you become the worst person in the meeting. Because you're miserable because God is moving and you was hoping that it didn't work out, but it is working out, so you become miserable. It's like when you let somebody go and then they prosper and you're like, why is God blessing them? Well, you let them go. Miserable people love to be miserable. And they'll show up to see how things are going, not to engage God. You ever see somebody that just checks your Facebook to see what type of trip you've been on lately?
Yeah.
You traveling, you buying stuff, you taking pictures with your boo and with your family, and God is blessing, and then the moment they hear something bad about you, they say, I guess it wasn't so perfect. They're miserable.
Yeah.
See, Facebook tells a story about what I want you to know. I don't want you to see me all messed up in my hair. That's why when I get on Facebook, I have my hair cut. I don't wake up with a bonnet on. Y'all ain't said no word. I'm coming to you. I can't wear no bonnet or no do-rag. It ain't gonna be no help. I give you the best of me. See, people that are not locked in the community, they become messy because they have nothing that is occupying their focus. But if you got locked into this church and you found the ministry to get a part of and you stop just looking around, talking about the old you and how you used to do this. No, if you get locked into now, you'll stop being messy.
Amen.
Only got two amens because we love to be messy. You'll stop being miserable.
Yeah.
Number three, you'll stop being a mumbler.
Uh-huh.
You know mumblers, don't you? And while the preacher's preaching, everyone got something to say. I don't even know that's in the Bible. Go check it.
Yeah.
I can't believe he said that. Yeah, I did. I can't believe he's talking like that. Not church fathers, yes. Mumbling. Because there's no community. You're not locked in, so you're detached, but you're here just enough to keep up. You're here just enough to vote. You're here just enough to make an impact.
Right.
But you're not here for God. You're here to cause trouble. Community equals. When I lock in, I go with you when you're low.
That's right.
And I go with you when you're high.
Yes.
I go with you when you make changes.
Yes, sir.
I go with you when you succeed.
Amen.
In other words, because I'm locked in, it don't just mean I'm locked in because I've been there, but I'm locked in. Because God is here. Can I tell you, I'll stop pastoring even when God is gone. But as long as God's here, I'm locked in.
That's right.
The problem is, but we don't get like righteous pastoral nugget. Righteous, find somewhere to serve in this ministry.
That's good.
Yeah. No, hear me again. You got to find somewhere to serve. You got to find somewhere. Well, everything should find somewhere to serve. Ask the Lord, say, Lord, where do you need me? And I ain't talking about somewhere where somebody talks. No, Lord, where do you need me in this season? And can I tell you that if you lock in, it's going to cause you to not have to seek God, because when you're dealing with God's people, they'll make you mad, and if you don't really see God, you'll go off on the deep end. Have you ever not been prayed up and somebody get on your nerves and you revert back to the old you? I know I get some help right there, but some of y'all did it before y'all got the church. Y'all ain't said nothing to me. Have you ever reverted back? Because ministry makes you humble.
Yes, sir.
When you're really doing this for God,
yeah,
it makes you humble yourself before Him.
Yes, sir.
Because somebody's always looking for a crack in your armor.
That's right. That's good.
And can I help you out? They're going to find you. Because you're human. But tell them, give me the super glue. I can get that crack. And guess what? When I fix this crack, there's going to be another crack.
Right.
So instead of you pointing out and leaving me there, bring me a solution to help me with the cracks in my arm.
Come on now. That's good.
All right, so listen, if you've been out, if you haven't served in a while, if you've been offended, if you've been, you know, this and that, find somewhere to serve.
Bye.
Can I tell you that when pastor doesn't see you at church, I don't see an empty seat. You know what I see when I don't see people at church? The reason I talk about coming to church a lot, when I see people miss church and miss opportunities of worship and miss opportunities to serve, you know what I see? I see open doors.
Yeah.
I see that at the moment, this is pastor's view, at a moment's notice, you can go right back to where you used to be. That the more you lock in, the stronger your muscles become and the stronger your resistance comes to going back. So when I don't see you at Bible study, I don't judge you, but I'm like, Lord, help them, because they need to know that as they grow in the Word, they'll become stronger. See, I don't see empty seats and missed tithes and missed offerings. I see a missed opportunity for you to grow in God. Can I tell you that if you don't find somewhere to serve in this ministry, if you don't find somewhere to connect, if you don't find common ground, it's going to be easy for you to slip out the back door. That's why people love the background ministry. The background ministry is what we used to do when we used to shoot dice. And y'all remember this? You shoot dice, you wouldn't be the main roller. You would do this. You would have the side man. I'm going to help some of y'all out because I ain't always been saying. You would have the side man. The side man ain't the main roller. Let me just help y'all out. This ain't in my text, but I'm going to come here real quick. The side man would make the side, you would make the bet on a person that's really rolling. But when he loses, I can get my money and slip out. And the problem is that when we are in the background ministry, it's easy for us to slip out when things don't go our way.
Come on. That's good.
But when you're locked in, you have a voice and you can say, wait a second, let's write this ship. And let's write the ship based on what the Word says. I told him in leadership class this morning, we got to stop going after our gut. And we got to say, Holy Ghost, how are you leading us?
Yeah.
Human wisdom must submit to God's word.
That's right.
Amen.
I don't know who this is for, but you gotta find somewhere. Lord, where can you use me?
Yeah.
Lord, not only where can you use me, Lord, here's what I desire, but God, I need you to give me enough tenacity to get in there and lock in and say, God, I'm in it. I'm in it. Can I tell you why people don't lock in? It's because that's accountability, man.
Right.
See, if you do it one time, I'm expecting you to do it
again.
And we feel like we can't get there. And so instead of me even just faking it, I won't do nothing. But God is saying, I need you to, somebody say, lock in. He says, a man who separates himself, he seeks his own desires. In other words, when you are isolated, nobody's talking to you, and you ain't talking to nobody. So you're left with your own mind. And sometimes your mind can play tricks on you. It can tell you stuff that ain't true.
Yep.
I preached a sermon about abortion. Minister Cornell came to me and said, somebody asked me a question. Because one of the points on why I was talking about abortion was, is abortion sin? And we said yes. Then I said, is this sin unforgivable? And the answer to that question was no. Well, that part of persons or people thought I said that that sin could not be forgiven. And the point was, watch this, it is not an unforgivable sin that God can forgive you. But if that person would have been left to themselves, guess what? Their mind would have told them I said one thing when I really meant another thing. Says this, Lord, fire somewhere. Look at part B. He quarrels against all sound wisdom. A person that's isolated quarrels against all sound wisdom. Write this down. Those type of people look for easy excuses. They look for excuses. They look for a reason not to worship. They look for a reason not to serve. They say things like, everything's changed. They say things like, we're moving too fast. And so they look for easy excuses. In other words, they don't even want sound understanding. They just want to do what they want to do. Here's what he says in the Wisdom series. He says, write this down. Church attendance is not the same as worship. Write it down. Church attendance is not the same as worship. Okay, can I help you out real quickly? That according to our bylaws, that if you miss 90 days of worship, you don't give, you don't show up, and you don't support the church, according to the bylaws, you are not a member. So what people will do is every 90 days or so, they'll show up to start the clock again. If I show up on the 89th day, the clock starts again. That's not the same as worship. I don't want you to come to start the clock. I want you to come to visualize your God as your only hope and your only source and put your focus on Him. Church attendance says, I'm just coming to be seen. Worship says, I'm coming to be engaged. Worship says, God, I had a long week and the only man that has answers are you. God, I don't know how I'm going to fix this problem. Worship says, I'm coming to worship holy God because I know that although I'm walking through the valley of the shadow of death, I'm not going to fear no evil because why? You are with me. That's what worship is. Church attendance says, I'm just showing up to see what's been going on. Church attendance says, I'm just here so they keep my name on the roll. But worship says that even my name ain't on this roll. Y'all ain't said nothing to me. My name is written in the Lamb's book of life. If I die tonight and y'all didn't bury me here, that don't make no difference. I'm still going to glory. Anybody happy that you're saved? Sanctified, filled with the precious gift of the Holy Ghost? Anybody happy? He says, church attendance is not, listen to pastor. I know this is not one of those shouting messages, but it's a message for us to receive because I don't want us ignorant about church attendance and worship. Just because you come here, I don't know if you're saved or not. That's why we give you Christ. Because just because you showed up don't mean that you're blood bought. Does mean that you want Him. Doesn't mean that you may have Him. So we have to present Christ to you every week. Why? Because we don't know what happened between Sunday to Sunday. He says in the text, he quarrels, he fights against all sound. Have you ever talked to somebody? You tried to help them through a situation, try to help them see it from the Bible point, and they just quit. They just quit. They keep fighting. You say, no, brother, 2 + 2 = 4. Well, sometimes equal 5. Where? Well, because when you go back in the Mayan days in Egypt, it's always been 4. They fight against wisdom. Hey, man, you need to come to church. Well, last time I was there, the preacher stepped on my toe. Well, come on back. He may pinch your arm this week. I ain't coming back because, you know, they don't take communion like they used to. Well, just come back. You can still take communion. They don't pray like we used to pray. Well, just come back. They still pray. In other words, they keep finding and finding easy excuses. Can I tell you fight, what the Bible says, against understanding.
Man.
You ever told your children something and they keep arguing with you like they know more than you?
Man.
I've never seen so many smart 16-year-olds.
Man.
I mean, you know everything. You know how to pay bills.
Maintain your room, right?
You know how to run a household?
Man.
Teach me something, because I guess you know everything. God says, look at this verse, y'all. He quarrels against, watch this, all sound wisdom. Not just biblical wisdom, anybody's type of wisdom.
Man.
If you keep cussing her out, she's going to leave you. That's how my daddy did. Well, when she leaves, now you're like, oh God, what happened? Well, I told you. You keep treating him any kind of way, he's going to leave you. No, I got something going to keep him. No, you don't. You think you do, but you don't. And then he leaves. But you don't listen to no wisdom. He quarrels against. You know why? Because he's not a part of a community.
Right?
He or she is out here trying to do it on their own. Trying to find God. Trying to find spirituality. But no, you find God in this word. You find God in koinonia. You find God in community.
Man.
Look what he says in verse 2. Look what he says in verse 2. A fool, there he goes again. A fool does not delight in understanding.
Man.
Some people are mad because they don't even want to know the truth. They want to live in their lie because their lie feels good to their emotions. Can I tell you that white America, you know, did black people wrong? Can I tell you that's the truth?
Yes.
But the truth of the matter is for us to get over that,
right,
is that only we have to educate ourselves.
Yeah.
But I don't care what black power and what Pan-Africans say, we need to get back to this word. Because you ain't going to make it out of poverty on reparations alone. If they give half of us reparations, we'll be back in debt because we're buying cars and planes and taking trips to Fiji. So God said, I can't give you no reparations because if I give you reparations, but your mind has not been renewed, that $1 million they gave you, you go back in debt. How you going to debt if somebody gave you $1 million? Because your mind wasn't renewed. You talking about reparations, but you ain't been born again. You talking about reparations, but you have not repented.
Come on.
And the God we serve is not white. The God we serve is not black. The God we serve is a spirit. He's not for black people. He's not for white people. He's for all those who now make his son Lord of. I said it again. I keep saying it. Anybody don't bother me? Fools do not delight in understanding. They hate it. You tell them something about the word, they don't want to hear it. They come with all types of things why they can't obey God's word. They're a fool. They're a fool. You hear the preacher preach, they don't want to hear that. Because he put his pants on just like I do.
Man.
They don't delight in understanding. They look at age. They can't teach me nothing. You got that right. I ain't teaching you nothing. I'm just showing you what the word is saying.
Yeah.
Oh, don't delight.
Yeah.
And I'm going to tell you something. You see an old fool? I told you this last week. They once was a young fool.
Yeah.
That's right.
Female and male.
That's right.
Got some foolish women. Got some foolish men.
Man.
It's all because, look at the verse, they don't delight in understanding.
Man.
They don't like community. They say things like, I just mind my business. But you don't pray for nobody. I know you don't mind your business, you know everybody else's business. I know that's a lie. God ain't asked you to pray when you get the tea. You don't pray for nobody? Or do you keep it going? Pass, your turn. No, it ain't my turn. My turn is to stop that foolishness and to lift it up to God.
Amen.
Fools don't delight in understanding. Write this down, that motives matter.
Amen.
Yeah. Why you're at this church, it matters. Why you are serving God, it matters. Y'all still woke? Motives, your heart matters.
Man.
There's a reason you haven't locked into a ministry. There's the motive behind that.
Yeah.
There's a motive behind why you give what you want as opposed to what God told you. There's a reason why you say amen when certain people preach and other people don't.
Come on now.
There's a reason why you go to certain things, you know, motives. Matt, look what he says. He said, the fool's on the light. In other words, that if I don't get my heart right, my motives will be wrong. If my motives are wrong, God can't be glorified.
Amen.
Say it again. If I don't get my heart right, my motives will be wrong. If my motives are wrong, God can't be glorified. Can I tell you that if God is not glorified, we are in trouble?
Amen.
Look at somebody and say, your motives matter.
Your motives matter.
How you treat people.
Right.
Am I loving you and respecting you in front of people so they think we're good? Well, guess what? My motives are wrong.
Right.
I'm saying, Lord, challenge all of us, including the preacher. Lord, check my heart for my motives.
Amen.
Am I only preaching to get offering, or am I preaching because they don't ever give me nothing?
Right.
Am I only singing because I want to be seen, or am I singing because I want to lift him up?
Amen.
Am I serving so I can make decisions in the church, or am I serving because I want to glorify him? Somebody say, motives matter. Here's the newest nugget I want you to catch out of this motives matter. That approval, write this down, approval and counsel are two different things. Okay, so let me help you out. Everybody in here is an adult, because the children are on the side. You don't need my approval. You don't need my approval. You're a believer. You're an adult. But as a pastor, my job is to give you counsel.
Right.
You do need approval to do things in this ministry because I've been governed and in charge to now watch out for the body of Christ. So you do need approval in that stand. But to do your own thing, you don't need approval. But you do need to seek counsel. The problem is we think counsel is approval. Can I tell you that if I tell you something and you don't follow it, that's on you? You need God's approval. And can I tell you, a lot of stuff that we're doing, he's not approving.
Come on now.
How we're acting,
yeah.
He's not approving. But I want God to approve my worship.
Yeah.
I'm trying to help somebody in here. God, I want you to approve how I love my neighbor. And God, I want you to prove that when I get it wrong, I'm man enough, I'm woman enough to say, I was wrong.
Amen.
I made a mistake. That's on me. Can you forgive me? Now guess what? That's on that person to forgive me. If they don't forgive me, I will still say, this is the day that the Lord has made. I'm going to rejoice because I came and I said, hey, I made a mistake. I missed the boat. That was on me. Well, you just keep doing it. That's on me. When you pray for me, but guess what? That's on me. Will you forgive me? I don't know. But I ain't got no time to wait on you. I asked you if you said yes or no. That's between you and God. I did my part.
Amen.
Problem is that we think counsel is approval. So we say in our mind, I don't need to get nobody's approval. Well, yes, you do.
Exactly.
Is God okay with how you're running your life?
Yeah.
Is God okay with how you're running your marriage?
Right.
Is God okay how you handle your money? And if you can't say yes to that, guess what? You need to seek some counsel. Because the Bible says in the multitude of counselors there is, he says, a fool does not delight there. But a fool only in reveling in his own mind. Reveling in his own mind. In other words, this fool doesn't like understanding. He only likes what he thinks in his own mind. Because he's isolated. You ever know somebody to talk about themselves so much? I got a new car. Man, that's good. Praise God. Got a new house. Man, that's good too, man. You know, I'm about to take a wife with you. That's good. That's good. When the last time you been at church? I don't even. Well, you tell me all this stuff you're doing. But now I'm going to ask about your relationship with God. Now you're stuttering. When you told me how much money you made last year, you was able to articulate that. When you told me how many cars you bought, you were able to articulate that. Now, I'm asking you how you're doing with God. And now you, wait a second, what's up? A fool doesn't like that understanding, but they like to do stuff in their own mind. Can I help you out? That approval is not, and counsel is a good thing, but here's the last thing. and I'm getting out of your way, that we need to, Lord, to deliver us from spiritual tantrums. Spiritual temper tantrums. We need God to deliver us from that. That we got to stop talking about all the stuff we doing. We got to stop talking about the stuff that he needs us to do. I don't want to hear about your toys and your stuff without also hearing about how you're getting closer to God. I don't mind hearing a testimony about the goodness of God, but I also want to hear, are you getting stronger in your community? Are you building somebody else up in the church? Are you helping the church with their vision to move forward? Or is this a billboard just about you? Every time we come around, we got to hear about what you're doing, but we ain't hearing nothing about how God is orchestrating your life. I want to be around people who are trying to grow spiritually. Yeah, I'm not saying you can't tell me how good God is. I want to hear that God healed your body. I want to hear about how God gave you a raise on your child. But after you tell me about all the stuff that's happened to you, tell me how you gave him glory. Tell me about how you stood in your child. You told about the goodness of the Lord. Tell me how you prayed for the sick and shut in. Tell me about how you came to worship. You came in heavy, but you left light. Tell me about how you was down, but God reached way down and lifted you up. Tell me about how good. Look at your members and never tell me about his goodness. Don't just tell me about the toys, but tell me about how you had the toil all night, but God came. Don't just tell me about your blessing, but tell me about the blesser. Put your attention on God and say, God, I thank you for the car. I thank you for the house. I thank you for the raise. But don't none of that mean nothing if you ain't involved in my life. Don't none of that mean nothing if, God, you ain't getting the glory. So, God, the toys don't have me, but my community has me. And can I help some of y'all out that the church family is not just here when you need them? Guess what? You need to be here for somebody else. If you're the only person that the church family is here for, that is a selfish, one-sided relationship. But there's going to come a time where God has blessed you, and you need to return that and be a blessing. Can I tell you, the church prayed for you. I need you to pray for somebody else. The church prayed for you, son. I need you to pray for somebody else's son. The church prayed for your marriage. I need you to pray for somebody else's marriage. Look at somebody and say, stop throwing spiritual tantrums. And the moment that things don't go your way, you pick all your stuff up and get mad at God. But I'm telling somebody right now that in this season, you need community, because God is on his way back. And he's looking for people that now can say, God, I really, really need something from you. I didn't just come here to look around. Y'all staring out, but look at the preacher right here. I didn't come to look at you, but I came to find out, God, how can I give you glory? How can you get the best out of my life? My marriage ain't where it needs to be with God. I came to find out how my community can help me out. And the next time somebody tells you something, you stop taking their business and running with it. If somebody tells you something, they're telling you because they believe you can get a prayer for it. But if you ain't the right person and this ain't the right season, just be honest and say, listen, don't tell me nothing, because I'm not in a good season of my life. And if you tell me, I'm going to gossip. See, we need to have honesty around here.
Yeah, yeah.
If somebody comes to you and say, don't tell me. If you tell me, I'm going to gossip. But catch me 2 months from now, and hopefully I'll pray for you. Right. The next time somebody trusts you, you need to be in a position to use that information and take it to God. And say, God, my brother and my sister, they need some help. They got a trial that they can't fix. They got a situation that they need you to come through. And they came to me because they believe that I know you. So that they'll know that I know you, I'm asking you, God, touch their life. Touch their finances. And touch their marriage. Touch everything that's concerning them. Because I believe that I'm a part of a community. And if I'm a part of a community, that means that I'm going to grow spiritually. But look at somebody and say, get connected. Come on, tell somebody, lock in. Now they look at you with an attitude, say, why you got an attitude for? God brought you here not to sit, but to serve. God said, if you get a part of the community, you'll see your walk of God go higher in him. Lean on your neighbor and say, neighbor, I need you to grow. I need your prayers to help me get stronger in God. I need your hallelujah to make me feel all right. I said, lean on your neighbor. And say, neighbor, I came in heavy. But by the mere fact that I'm sitting next to you, I feel lighter because your praise is helping me get through. That's why we need community. That's why we need a church home. Because we can't fight on our own. But we need the ecclesia. And the ecclesia is the church. We need a community that's not just gossipers. But we need a community that can help me fight that this battle that I'm in. I can't make it on my own. But I just believe that I sat by the right person. And this person is not a fool. But this person is a worshiper. You need to do a roll check and say, neighbor, I ain't talking about you. But I'm going to make sure that I'm not sitting next to the fools. But I'm sitting next to people who know that God is a good God.
You're a part of.
Stay winning. Winning your marriage. Winning your money.
Yeah.
Well, God, every time I read the Bible, I get sleepy. That It's Satan's job. Just like when I start preaching, somebody texts you, they had an emergency. They know you at church. They know you at church. An emergency is come change my light bulb. Come change my gas tank. You know you was out of gas before you left home? God, fix me. Whatever's not like you, I'm trying to grow spiritually. Can't worry about the chat. Chatter is chatter, but if it's Bible, I'll listen to that. Because my sheep know my voice. But a stranger chatter. Never seen so many people be led astray by other grown folk.
Man.
But you stand on how grown you are and how tough you are. The moment somebody says something to you, it pulls you from God.
Man.
Community fools don't like community. Stand to your feet, really. Fools don't like you.
Man.
They despise, they quarrel against it.
Man.
I ain't gonna be right till I feel it. What if you died in that offense? If you died, because you had to be right. Some of you are looking to make decisions. I'm asking you to seek God's counsel on your decisions that you're making for your family, for your ministry, for your life. This is not eight churches in one. We're one church. It's following God. And we all are going to make mistakes. And that's why we have a community. That when you fall, I can help lift you up. Not throw you to the wolves. See, I knew they wouldn't say. No, that's not what community does. That's what the world does. Church don't do that. Church said, nah, brother, come on.
Right.
Come on, kicking and screaming. The community says, I got to have a tough conversation with you.
That's right.
Hey, man, what's up? What's going on? And who are you? I ain't come for all that. I'm saying, what's going on? I ain't seen you in a while. What's up?
Right.
That's community.
Yeah.
We don't have that. What we'll do is we'll talk about him with somebody else. Talking about we praying for him.
Yeah.
I'm using an excuse. I'm using an example. I ain't seen Mr. Cornell in a while. He right over there. I can go to him and call him and say, hey, man, I ain't seen you in a while. What's up, bro? Well, you always here. Some folks online don't think you don't come to church. You always here. Drew, what's up? What's going on? Like, I see you in prayer. Man, who are you? What's up? Hey, Brian, come on. I was holding you accountable. I see you in Bible study. You be in Bible study. I'm just using an example. Nikki, why you ain't singing no more? What's going on? Community can have tough conversations.
Yeah.
Problem with our community is that the moment we have tough conversations, it's time to take our marbles and run. They're judging me. I'm offended. Community equals spiritual growth.
Right.
Deacon should be able to come to you anytime and say, what's going on? Can I pray with you? Man, we got our day together. That don't mean nothing, brother. I'm holding you accountable right now. We came to church with a slave. That don't mean nothing to me right now. I'm holding you. I'm looking out for your spiritual growth. Church, look at me. This is called grown folk talk.
Yeah.
And the reason most families go to family reunions and they have fights is because nobody had a grown folk talk.
Yeah.
Nobody told Uncle Bud that every time you come drunk, you mess up the event. No other man told him that. Auntie, when you come with all that gossip, you mess up the family reunion, you mess up the cookout. Nobody had a grown conversation. And in the church, we don't have them. So we'll take what the preacher says, we'll go home, and we don't. But somebody should be holding the community accountable. Hey, I miss you in worship. Hey, I miss you in Bible study. I miss you in Sunday school. Is everything okay? And you'll find out there's some things that you can help with. I ain't talking about just one time. This person ain't been. Pray pray for them first. Listen, God, give me the right words.
Amen.
Pastor, that's challenging, Pastor, because you don't know what I may get as a result of that. Got a question. I'm done praying. If God told you that what you say to this person may save them or lead them to hell, would you still do it? Every conversation that you're having with somebody is a life or death conversation when it comes to them obeying this.
Yeah.
My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Here's a text. But because they have rejected, they became a fool.
Yeah.
They knew more. It don't take all that. I don't like when he does that. Get past all of that junk that you're trying to tell yourself and hear ye the word of the Lord. I don't like when he sweat. I don't like, get past all that junk. You're not a real man unless you submit to God. You're not a real woman unless you can submit to God. I don't care how many jobs you got. I don't care how many cars you can fix. I don't care how many cakes you can bake. True manhood and true womanhood is based on how we serve and submit to God first. That's the first thing. I said it, and then from there, Father, in Jesus' name, help us submit to your word. These sermons are not easy to hear. They're also not easy to preach. Father, we need wisdom. It is the principal thing. But fools despise it. Help us not be a fool. Help us not be rejecting of the word. Help us not be so easily offended, including the pastor, including the deacons and everybody. God, help us. We just want to grow stronger in you. Those that came for the first time, and God, maybe they're like, man, this hurt a little bit. Father, be the balm in Gilead. Heal them. But you shall know the truth. Truth shall make you free. Help us, God, understand the word. We give you praise and we give you glory in Jesus' name. The minister's coming to open the doors of the kingdom. Let's give the Lord praise.
First time, you're a little nervous. That's fine.
wave your hand. Somebody will come to you. Somebody will come get you. Or look at your neighbor and ask your neighbor, would you go down with me? Would you walk down with me? We don't want you to leave out the door the same way you walked in. The second invitation I want to extend is rededication. Maybe you're in a backslidden state, and it's hard for you to get back to the family. It's hard for you to get back to the fold. Well, I extend rededication to you. Online, type into the chat box. Somebody will prompt you to get back to you. We don't want you to walk out this door feeling the same way you came in. I want you to come down. Bring all of your problems down. It don't matter. If you got a headache, bring your headache down. If you're feeling sick, come down with the sickness. Put a mask on and come down with the sickness. If you're questioning about it, come on down. Don't be ashamed. Don't be scared. Nobody's here to judge you. We're here to pray with you and for you. Rededication. Maybe you are sick and you need to be in a good Bible-based preaching church. I offer to you church membership. We don't want you to come every 90 days. We want you to come every time the doors are open. Church membership. Again, if you're new or you're online, you're new, type into the chat box. And if you're in here, you're a little nervous. A lot of people, that's fine. Ask somebody to walk down with you or wave your hand at me. Somebody will come get you. You don't want to walk out? Wave your hand at me. Somebody come and stand right there with you and pray with you. Take advantage of this. This part is free. Jesus already paid for everything that we're talking about right now. It's already paid for. Only thing you have to do is move on. That's it. You don't have to give us your social security number, reach your wallet, in it. All you have to do is move on. That's it. We'll give you a few more seconds. Salvation, rededication, church membership. If any one of those fits you, we want you to come. Will there be one? Will there be one? We see that there is none, but there is still room at the cross. Let us pray. Heavenly Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this awesome man of God that you've given us, who is preaching your word, Lord God. Father, allow us to open the ear in our hearts, Lord God. Allow us to bury your word deep in our hearts, Lord God, that we may not sin against you. Father God, I ask that you would just begin to touch that heart, Lord God. I ask that you begin to touch that mind, Lord God, who's curious about who you are and what you can accomplish. Father, I ask that you just continue to move in such a way, Lord God, that we can do nothing but give you all the glory, honor, and praise that you so rightfully deserve. Lord God, I'm praying over everyone under the sound of my voice, Lord God, that you would touch their homes even right now. I pray, Lord God, that you would touch their physical, whatever it is, that pain that they're feeling in their bodies, Lord God. I ask that you would touch and heal right now. Father God, I ask that you would touch somebody's finances right now. Touch somebody's marriage right now, Lord God. Touch a friendship that was broken, Father God. Touch a relationship that might need repairing, Lord God. Father God, that you would bring them back to you, Lord God, and that their lives can be a testimony of what you've done. Father God, I thank you for these your people. And in Jesus' name we pray. Let every heart say, amen. Thank you, brothers and sisters. It is seed time. Seed time. I don't know about nobody else, but I thank God that I'm able to give. I'm telling you, it makes me happy to give. I ain't one of these people that's like, oh, it's time to tie. No, we'll get to that point. Because I'm a firm believer that if you give to God, He'll give it back to you. Press down. Run it over. Man, you got a seed in your hand. You got a seed in your hand. I want you to lift those seeds up. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for these seeds, Lord God, if we're able to sow them. Lord God, we ask that you would water them, Lord God. We ask that you would just continue to bless us, Lord God, that we're able to give and we also able to reap harvest, Lord God, where your word says, as long as there's The earth remain your be seed time, talk time, Lord God. We also come into agreement with Malachi 3:10. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, for those things, those seeds that we have sown, Lord God, in the spiritual, Lord God, and we thank you that we are reaping those in the natural, Lord God. But also thanking you, Lord God, for contracts for entrepreneurs, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that generations are to come, Lord God, are financially set because of the seeds we're sowing right now. We thank you for generational health and wealth, Lord God. We ask that you would just allow, Lord God, us to sow, Lord God, not just to sow what we feel we owe, Lord God, but give us something in our hearts that's going to allow us to sow more and more into your kingdom, not for us, but for your glory, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God. We praise you. We honor you. And we cannot say this enough, Lord God. We thank you. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Every heart said, amen.
Voting on that next Sunday. It's
states that can't be in the office for 4 years or longer. We need to vote every year. So what's going to happen is that if you want to be considered as a superintendent, here are the criteria. Number one, you need to have completed 5-star leadership. Amen. I think you also need to be in Sunday school and active in Sunday school. And so you can call the front office. You're a member in good standing. Call the front office on Monday and say, hi, I would like to be recommended or considered for that position. Your name will go on a ballot, and they will vote on that ballot at Sunday school next week. We're not going to hold a special meeting for that, all right? So you just know that that ballot will be circulated around in Sunday school next week. Also, all of the leadership positions that are voting in, Deaconess Ministry already had their voting, and there's some other auxiliaries that you need to vote on in your ministry. Take that time at your auxiliary meeting and vote on that next leadership role and have that. If you want to have that for our meeting, you can. Or you can have it for the church meeting on December 10th. I'm going to make myself clear again, Sunday school superintendent, if you're looking to be considered for that, your name will go on the ballot, they'll pass that ballot around, and then they will count those ballots. Same thing for each leadership ministry auxiliary. Make sure that you are voting for your leadership ship for the next year, how that wants to go. If there are questions for that, you can call the front office or you can see me after church and I can give you more information. Now, if that affects you, then ask me. If you're trying to be nosy, don't ask me. I don't have time for that, okay? But you got to make that clear. If that affects you, say, hey, Pastor, I want to get more information. I'll be right here. I can explain it to you. If you're just looking to get more information just to have it, let's just say that for another time. All right, last but not least, we have a video that we want to share with you about our Kingdom Builders Ministry. After church, immediately after church, they're holding a scrimmage and an informational. If you have grandchildren, if you have children that were a part of Upper Sports, we've combined Upper Sports and put them in the umbrella of Kingdom Builders for all ages, all the way up to 17, 18. Next door in our fellowship hall, there's some healthy foods, there's some healthy tips. Right after that, we're going to go to the gym for a small scrimmage. Please, 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 if you can stay, support the young people, support Kingdom Builders and Sister Devetta. Let's take a moment and let's watch this video together. Opportunity to start real quickly. Stick with the same. Technology is great when it works.
Most, but I do a lot. I'ma make a toast, cause we still alive. No big, I feel like pop. I shoot the shot. I'm coming in.
Y'all know it. This is so.
Can we clap our hands for that? People of God, come on. Thank God for Brother Fernandez with his skills on the video. Let's give God praise for him. Amen. Now, I am a little upset. They didn't get my footage of me playing back there. I don't know how that was left out, Fernandez, but that didn't make the cut. Praise God. Amen. But that's today. Registration starts today, November 13th. Again, if you have a grandbaby, let's see this light too. If we have a grandbaby, or if you have a child that you want to do cheer, or you want to do basketball, we need you to come out, be involved with it. Amen. Registration is here. Those are the practice jerseys. They have some other jerseys coming, but we want to get this back. COVID tried to knock this out. Amen. But we thank God that we're getting this back together. If you were a part of this ministry before, there's no reason for you not to get connected. Sister Javetta, Sister Charlotte, wave your hand back there if you want to get connected. Come on, see them. If you want to coach, if you want to donate. So next door, after I get done praying, greet the saints of God. If you have other questions about the Sunday school or the elections, you can come see me, but go next door. Amen. Be a part of the Healthy Living Expo they have going. And then we're going to go right to the gym, do the scrimmage, and we'll adjourn there, okay? Praise God. Let's keep everybody in the sickness shutting in our prayers. Again, Deacon Skinner's doing well. I called him. He had a mild stroke, but he's doing a whole lot better. Praise God. He's in rehab right now, so the Lord is good. The Lord is kind. So we thank God for that. Join us on Wednesday night for a Bible study. And don't forget that we have about three. How many churches we got now? 48. So we're almost at 100, right? So we need 50. Is my math right? 52? 52. I think my math is right. Carry the one. Yeah, 52. Amen. But I have to get to it. So we got certificates?
Next Sunday.
Praise God. We got certificates next Sunday, so let's make sure we get those. Let's stand to our feet, saints. Amen. Somebody say community.
Community.
Equals spiritual growth.
Spiritual growth.
We're going to grow. We're going to grow together. We're going to do it together. Good to see everybody here. Any first-time visitors here that we already greet them? Any first-time visitors? Any first-time visitors online? Amen. Let's give them a hand clap of praise. Come on. Make sure we see you before we leave. Amen. Amen. Let's come into agreement with God's word. It is a scrimmage today, so let's go next door if we can. Let's come into agreement with Numbers chapter 6. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto Aaron and to his sons, saying, on this wise you shall bless the children of Israel. Say unto them, the Lord bless you, the Lord keep thee, the Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. They shall put my name on the children of Israel, and I will bless them. I think we have men's ministry tomorrow too, right, Dee? Men's ministry tomorrow, and women's ministry tomorrow as well. Tomorrow on the campus, if you want to come out to men's ministry and women's ministry, not only the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost, may it rest, rule, and abide. Be with you hence, now, and forevermore. Speak a blessing over your life, even if you're online or in the sanctuary. It cannot be reversed, for it's a blessing that comes only from the Lord. What I say unto one, I say unto all, watch and pray until we meet again. Have a great week. We'll see you next door. Be blessed.